Hi, it's Steve. Today is day 4 of my 30 days of video series, and it's also day 4 of my water fasting experiment. I'm aiming to go about 30 days water fasting, and of course to finish the whole video series. I'd say the fast is going pretty well so far. I think I'm through the worst of it. The hardest is usually the first 3 days, and now I'm like around 3.5 days. It's coming up on 6 p.m. at 6 p.m. on day 4, so that's come along pretty well. I've been a little bit hungry lately, thinking about food a bit, but the hunger is starting to go away, so that makes it a lot easier. This is around the time in a fast when the hunger should start to fade, and probably by tomorrow, I would guess the hunger will be mostly gone, and I'll just have to deal with the lower physical energy from that point onward, but it gets a lot easier. I can already feel it's getting much easier. Yesterday was actually a lot easier than I expected. I expected that to be the toughest day. And I think in this case, actually day 2 was the toughest. And that that third day wasn't really that bad at all. The main thing is I was, you know, thinking about food now and then. One thing I actually find pretty comforting on a fast is to smell food. So I still have some food in my kitchen. I mostly used it up. Like I used up all the fresh produce before I started the fast. But I still have, you know, a few things in the fridge or in the pantry. And one of my, one thing that actually really helps a lot is just to have the scent of food in my life. Because when you're fasting, you're not just cutting out, the digestion, the eating, the calories. You're also cutting out the sensory experience of having a meal and the smells and the sight of food. The first time I did a water fast, a long one, like 17 days last year that I did, I thought going into it that it would probably be a bad idea to be around food or look at food because it would just be too tempting. That is true the first few days, I would say, but after the hunger starts going away, then I actually find it pretty comforting to go around, to be around food. So sometimes during that fast, I would just take a trip to the grocery store and walk around and look at food. And, you know, if there was some scent of food nearby, I would just smell that and it would, you know, it would be a positive experience for me. It wouldn't tempt me to want to break the fast early, not overly so, but just smelling that was actually pretty comforting and pretty grounding. And, there's some scents that are really nice to smell. Like probably my favorite one is peanut butter. Just like opening up a jar of peanut butter and smelling it. And it doesn't tempt me to want to eat it, but just like soaking up the aroma of peanut butter is just such a delight. And so when I'm fasting, it kind of reminds me to pay more attention to some of my other senses. I got a huge aromatherapy kit a while ago with more than 100 different scents. So I'll sometimes open up the bottles and just smell the essential oils. That can also become comforting, like the smell of vanilla or the smell of cinnamon. In any kind of sense can help to stimulate the senses. So that way it doesn't leave me feeling quite as deprived when I'm having, you know, the sensory experience, at least in some small way. Maybe if you're not fasting, it sounds a bit pathetic, but I do have to say it actually makes the fast easier to at least have that sense of smell being engaged and not lose that too. Today, I wanted to talk about this idea of facing fear and moving beyond fear. You know, I know there's a big part of personal development, and it's been a big part of my path of personal growth, to identify fears you have and to face them. Now, I'm not talking about genuine danger, like, you know, if somebody's attacking you with a knife, or if, you know, you're out in the woods and you see a grizzly bear coming at you. That, I think, is a very healthy fear to have, and when your fight or flight response gets engaged, and it's important for your own survival. So I'm not talking about overcoming those kinds of fears where your body will just react, you know, automatically. I'm talking about illogical fears, the kind that hold you back in life. Say, like fear of failure, fear of rejection, fear of making a mistake, fear of public speaking, fear of embarrassment and humiliation. Fear of what people might think of you, that sort of thing. The stuff that can limit you on your path through life. You know, the fact that you might be more timid than necessary. You might not speak up. You might not ask for a raise or promotion because you're afraid of hearing no. You might not ask for the sale. You might not start your own business because you're afraid you might fail. And this is partly what got me into personal growth in the first place. In fact, it was really overdoing this aspect that I got into initially. When I was, 18, I got caught up in shoplifting and doing all kinds of crazy illegal things. And I used to do it as like, it would be like my morning espresso. Initially it was like this thrill I would pursue. You get high on the adrenaline rush. And eventually I got a partner and we would do this, this shoplifting scheme together. And after doing that for, a year, 18 months, it got to the point where I could go into a department store and steal hundreds of dollars worth of merchandise and walk out the door, and my heart wouldn't skip a beat. It's like I was numb to it. The adrenaline rush went down quite a lot over time. You develop a tolerance. It's like a drug addiction in a way, where you need more and more and more. And so I would do crazier and crazier things to try to get that same kind of rush. And it got to the point where I would steal when I was drinking. I would, I broke into cars at one point just to do it. And that, that adrenaline high and the dopamine reward afterwards, they would just get lower and lower and lower. And that, fortunately I had an incident where I finally got out of that. But for the next year, I noticed that experience really muted a lot of my enjoyment of life. It made the highs I would have probably otherwise experienced much lower because my body was no longer generating so much of a stimulating feeling. And so I was mostly numb in a way for the whole year after that. And I think I had a good recovery path. I moved back to Los Angeles and I reconnected with some old friends from high school. And I just tried to have a very calm and unstimulating life for a while. I remember I used to play games with my friends at their fraternity at UCLA, and we'd watch movies together, like we'd play Risk and watch the Star Wars movies, and it really was not that exciting of a thing to do, but I really needed that time of getting away from that craziness, from that thrill of always pushing to face my fears and pushing on the courage button. On the other hand, that also made it so everything else in life after that didn't seem like such a big deal. Starting my own business didn't seem like such a big deal. So what if I fail? When I went bankrupt later, so what? A failure, no big deal, you move on from it. Getting a divorce, yeah, it was rough. It was definitely one of the hardest things I had to go through. But I think because I developed more of a tolerance for fear, for pain, it wasn't as difficult for me as it might have been, for other people going through these kinds of experiences. The danger of pushing so much on the courage aspect is that you can be numb to stimulation. It really can be like a drug, and you can condition your nervous system not to generate much stimulation or much of a positive response or much of an excitement. And you can start feeling pretty checked out from life. I have a lot of friends who are dating coaches, and many of them have gone through this path of developing and building their social courage, often by approaching people on the street and starting up conversations and, sometimes going to bars or clubs and seeing who they could get into bed and, racking up notches on their belt for how many people they slept with. That was like a thing they wanted to go experience. I never went through that phase myself, but I was curious about people who had done that, and I met some of them in person and talked to them. And I said, what was that path like? Like, where did it take you? And they often reached a point of just deep emptiness inside. They would see people they knew they could pick up and sleep with if they wanted to. They would even be able to explain how they would do it, but the will to do that just wouldn't be there because it became an empty experience. It was something they did for the thrill, something that initially was really exciting and really growth-oriented because it was allowing them to face their fears and build their courage, become a different kind of person. But something was missing. That pursuit of facing your fears and developing courage by itself was not enough. And I asked people, you know, from pursuing that, was it worth it? And some of them said yes, and some of them said no. The ones who said yes had found a positive way to pivot to something else, something more meaningful for them, like finding a really lasting, intimate relationship. And the ones who said no, that, you know, wasn't really a good experience, they didn't find that a way to get past that, like that became their whole pursuit in life, and they never really developed other skills like for intimacy and connection. So you know, that I found kind of interesting, and it's one of the reasons I've really avoided hammering so much on my courage after a while, just for the sake of building more courage, because I found it can actually make life less stimulating all around. When I got out of that shoplifting phase, and then I went through sort of a numb period, one of the ways I found to increase the stimulation level of my life, because I feel like I felt like I really needed that. I felt like I really wasn't in touch with who I was unless I was doing something to stretch myself. And so one positive way I found to stretch myself was to set ambitious goals. And that was a way of amping up the stimulation without doing something reckless or illegal. So in my case, I went back to school. I'd been previously kicked out of college, and I went back to school, started over as a freshman, and I set a really ambitious goal to get a 4-year degree in computer science in just 3 semesters. And so I took, you know, a much higher course load than normal, and, you know, really studied time management and pushed myself to achieve that goal. And I not only graduated in 3 semesters with a computer science degree, but I was also able to have a math major too. So I actually got 2 degrees in 3 semesters, and I received an award given to the top computer science student that year. And a lot of my teachers knew me, that I was taking all these units, and they said it wasn't even a challenge to pick who was going to win that year because of that. So that was a very positive experience, a very rewarding 3 semesters to go through. But at the same time, I feel like I missed something from that experience, because again, I was pushing so much on that stimulation side, and, you know, it was like really overemphasizing the development of my power internally. And, you know, if you've read my book, Personal Development for Smart People, you know, like the 3 core principles I live my life by are truth, love, and power. And, you know, power is your ability to create your reality the way you want it to be. And I certainly did a lot of that. You know, and then after college, I went on to start my own business, and I did a lot of that. But I felt like I pushed too much on that side of the triangle and not enough on the love aspect. Like, all through college, I never had a girlfriend. And in fact, you know, I remember at least a few occasions where there were women clearly indicating they were interested in me, and I just sort of brushed them off because I just wasn't really ready to develop that part of myself. And that's something, you know, if I regret anything about that experience, it's the fact that I didn't really have a balanced approach to personal growth back then. It was just very lopsided on one side of the triangle, like power and courage. And, you know, and courage is an interesting quality, because the way I define it in my book is it's actually a combination of power and love. It's finding power in love and kind of loving your power in a way. It sort of works both ways there. We often think of courage as facing your fears or feeling the fear and doing it anyway. And that is a way of looking at courage mostly from the power side. However, if we think about it a little bit more from the love side, we can go back to the root of the word courage, which is core, C-O-R, Latin, which basically means core or heart. And so another way of thinking about courage is that courage is heart-centeredness. So you can overcome and face your fears by pushing yourself on the power side to be brave. But another way to be motivated to face your fears is to feel more caring, more compassion, more centeredness in your heart, in the core of your being, and a genuine desire to contribute, to help people. That can actually help you face your fears. Take public speaking, for instance, something I've done a lot of, and I used to be very afraid of it. And now I'm really not afraid of it. You can develop skill in public speaking like I did initially, say by joining Toastmasters, and you practice a lot, and you just get up and do the things that scare you, and you do it over and over again. And it's basically a systematic desensitization approach where you build skill, you build experience, you get up in front of an audience, and you just keep doing it over and over again. My friend Darren LaCroix is the 2001 world champion of public speaking. And his mantra, you know, where he says the three most important things for gaining skill in public speaking are stage time. And, you know, I think there's definitely a lot of truth to that, that it's just a matter of doing it, getting up, you know, and start with like a 4 or 5 minute speech, and you build up to longer speeches, and you do different kinds of speeches, and you do this over a period of years. I was in Toastmasters for 6 years, and the fear definitely diminishes when you do that. For me, it didn't. That wasn't enough to get it to go away completely. For some people, you know, they practice a lot and it does really go down a lot, but not everybody gets rid of all the fear that way. The other component, which I think can help a lot too, especially when you have something to say and you're not just practicing your speaking skills for the sake of doing so, is to focus on the message and to really caring about the people and connecting with the audience. And that was really the piece I was missing that finally helped me overcome the last bit of fear related to public speaking. Is it wasn't just about working on the power side. It was about working on that love side. I found sort of by accident that with certain speeches, certain audiences, I wasn't nervous or I wasn't afraid. And the difference was that I had a message I really cared about and I was doing something I really thought would be beneficial for the people. And that got me more out of my head and into my heart while I was speaking. And instead of focusing so much on the words, the paragraphs, the content I was sharing, I focused on the people in the room, on the audience. And it was like having a conversation. You know, when you have a conversation with a good friend, you're probably focused more on the friendship. You don't necessarily think of that type of conversation as being a content-based medium for disseminating information to your friend. You know, suppose you're hanging out with a group of friends and you're just like laughing and joking around. It's like, where's your focus? It's on the friendship itself. It's on the connection. It's on the people. It's on the enjoyment of the experience. And when I started framing public speaking less as a performance and more as a conversation, that made a huge difference. It caused the fear to diminish and to go away. And I realized that I could really leverage that approach, and I wanted to see how far I could take that. So eventually in 2015, I did this workshop called the Conscious Heart Workshop. And I knew going into it would be a little bit difficult to sell, but we still had about 30 people there. And the premise of the workshop was that there's no set content. There's not even a set topic. I'm not going to prepare any content for it in advance. I'm just going to go with the flow of inspiration, connecting with the audience as we go along. So 3 days of that. So, you know, that was like, but by the time I was doing it, though, it was not really a courage thing on the power side. It was a courage thing on the love side. I wanted to see if I could stay connected and really focus on benefiting the audience, knowing that, okay, all the knowledge I'm going to share is, it's inside my brain somewhere. It'll come out eventually. I'd already done a bunch of 3-day workshops before that time, probably more than a dozen by that point. So it wasn't, you know, such a big stretch anymore to do that. At least in terms of my experience speaking. But I wanted to see, like, can I trust that the content will flow if I focus on the people, if I focus on the connection? And that was actually one of the best workshops I ever did. I had no nervousness or fear, either during, before, you know, throughout the event. And after each workshop, I normally do an exit survey. I ask people to go online and just, you know, fill out a survey to rank the different parts of the workshop, like on a scale of 1 to 5, what they thought of it, and give me some free-form text feedback. I really like to know what people thought of it. And this, you know, a typical workshop gets about a 4.5 average rating on each different category. And this one got slightly lower for the content, like around a 4.2 instead of a 4.5. And I thought, okay, because the content wasn't as organized. I'm just making it off the cuff as I go along. But the transformational experience and the overall value of the workshop, people rated more highly, about a 4.8, I think it was. And I thought, wow, it's like I almost maxed that one out, what people actually gained from it, what they got out of it. And I haven't done that workshop again because, again, it's how do you sell that? You know, you tell people come to a workshop and it's about, you know, who knows what. We'll make it up as we go along. But the cool thing about that is that the type of people who actually signed up for that kind of workshop were amazing people. Like, they were just real contributors, and they were, you know, they wanted to have an interesting experience, and it was a really fun workshop. It was really interesting. It was unpredictable, though. There was even some nudity in the room at that workshop twice. That happened, which had never happened in a previous workshop, and never since, so far at least. And that was totally unexpected. So it's like people felt so connected, so comfortable. Like, it's like a couple different people were able to get naked in the room during different exercises where it was not even part of the exercise and totally, you know, totally not required or even suggested. But, you know, strange stuff ended up happening. And because of that, I actually enjoyed the workshop so much more. It reconnected me with an interesting sense of stimulation. Like, I felt really in the flow and stimulated as I was going along. But that stimulation wasn't coming from facing my fear and pushing on the power side. That stimulation was coming from focusing on the connection and the love aspect and the caring and having fun and being playful and being creative. That is what I found in the long run. Is the kind of stimulation I really crave and I really enjoy beyond the using fear as a stimulation effect and you know, pushing on that power button to overcome your fears. And in a way, I think I'm still a bit numb to that power-based type of courage. It doesn't do much for me anymore. A few years ago, Rochelle and I went skydiving. And as I went through the experience, you know, I remember thinking it was a little bit of a letdown. So you fall, the parachute opens, and you fall some more, and you're on the ground. And it's over in, 20 minutes to go up in the plane, and then 5 minutes to come down. And Rochelle did it with me. She was the first one out of the plane. And she's also had some, you know, stimulating experiences where she's pushed herself. She's done some one-woman plays. And, you know, written her own plays and performed her own plays in front of an audience. So she's been subjected to critical reviews and things like that. So she's had a chance to face her fears as well. And I really don't think it was that big a deal to both of us to do that. Yet it seemed like something we should be scared of. And we had invited other people to do it. I think there were something like 8 people who said they were going to go do it with us. And when we told them the date and time, only 2 of them showed up. Everybody else seemed to have a convenient excuse. One friend admitted he was just scared. And then the other people are like, oh, my boss made me, you know, work and stuff. And so I thought, okay, interesting. It's like, you know, people were finding ways to cop out of that experience, and even though they knew it was coming up. But for me and Rochelle, it wasn't as big a deal, and it wasn't as big a deal to do that. And so that's helped me realize that I need to change the focus of my life in terms of personal development more, less away from building the power side of that triangle, because I feel like I've done so much work. That was really the side that got me into personal growth in the first place. And, I pushed on that so much. It's gotten to the point where I push on it and I have experiences that just feel empty afterwards. Like, yeah, maybe I faced yet another fear and I've like squeezed, you know, so many different irrational fears out of me, like wringing a towel dry. And now I just feel like I'm scraping the bottom of the barrel to come up with things that are worth doing, where it actually fulfills me or feels meaningful afterwards. I'm sure I can still feel, you know, come up with some things I'm hesitant to do. Maybe I get a bit of nervousness or anxiety about doing them. But that alone has no longer been a reason, at least not an intelligent or compelling reason, just to do things. You know, that was the kind of mindset that got me down on going down a very reckless path. Like, whatever I'm afraid of, let's go do it. I used to be like that when I was in my late teens. And I feel like, you know, I've really gotten that out of my system, and it's not providing more value to me. What I've found really provides more value in the long run is focusing on creating experiences that I feel like they're really me, like they're compatible with who I am. And that requires going more into the love side, especially delving into your desires. Like, what do you want to really experience in life? Now that you feel you're no longer limited by fear, what happens beyond that? Where else can you work on your personal growth? And so now it's, you know, my attention has turned more to the truth and love aspect. And those combine to create a sense of oneness, you know, where the truth of your reality is that you're experiencing your desires. What you love is your true reality. That, to me, is a place of oneness. And so that has become a much more interesting side of the triangle to work on. And it's creating a lot more balance in my life. And I'm finding that, you know, because of all the early work I did on that power side, that I can leverage to explore oneness in a much bigger way. Like, you know, working on Conscious Growth Club and not being afraid of that project. Or doing this video series with you and not feeling afraid or nervous to connect with you or communicate, even though I'm doing it through a new medium. I mean, I've done so many other things I was afraid to do. And this, I gotta tell you, like on a scale of 1 to 10 for how much fear and anxiety I have about it, it's like maybe a 1.5, if that. But I also know I need to build a lot of skill. So that's like the truth aspect. I have to, you know, find ways to make this work and learn about video, learn how to communicate intelligently through this medium. But it's no longer a fear, it never really was at this point, a fear thing for me to get into this. And so my goal in creating this video series and the part that stimulates me about it, it's not the power aspect or pushing through a fear or breaking through a personal limitation. It's finding deeper connection and compatibility through another medium, finding ways to connect with you, figuring out what value I can share that you like, how I can turn my lessons and experiences into something that benefits you. Like, that's really where my focus is. It's on that truth and love side of the triangle. You know, like let's just try something, connect. My desire is to help you live an amazing life, to help you transform your life. I also like the potential social ripples that this experiment might create, making more friends that, you know, I can meet up with. I just had a meetup this morning at a Starbucks with three people who are in Vegas temporarily. And that was, you know, it was kind of cool. We hung out, we talked for a couple hours. And, you know, we had talked about all kinds of different topics. That, you know, having the chance to just connect with people more deeply, focusing on intimacy in my relationship with my girlfriend, and having beautiful and fun and educational experiences with her where we grow and we build our skills, that is where I'm getting so much more richness out of life these days. It's not really on the power and the, you know, that power aspect of courage facing fears. That feels like something I've just squeezed so much, it's just not giving me any more juice. So, you know, part of the reason I want to share this is that if you're a little earlier on in your personal growth journey, especially with respect to facing your fear, I want to caution you not to overplay that card so much. I think it really is important to balance your personal growth path in the whole truth, love, and power, you know, triangle. Figure out where your weakest area is, work on that a bit, and then notice that you know, that weaker area that you've been working on, if you do that for several years, that might become your strongest area. And there's a tendency to want to keep working on that and keep pushing it. And if you overplay that, you can really unbalance your life. You can end up with end up as one of those people who has lots and lots of courage, but they feel empty inside. And I'm really glad I didn't end up that way. I could see a path where I might have ended up that way. And I feel very lucky that I didn't go that route. And so what I want to caution you to do is like, yeah, it's okay if you have some fears, but don't feel like that's always got to be your number one priority, to face your fears and to conquer them. Realize also that there's other paths of personal development, like discovering truth about your life, about reality, learning more about how the world works, discovering new knowledge and building new skills. That's a really important path of your development as well. And it's perfectly valid to just let your fears sit there and not work on them for a while you build skills and you gain knowledge and experience in other areas. Another thing, of course, is the love aspect, exploring your desires, what you really want to experience. And you may be able to explore a lot of your desires without having to face your fears too much. Now, if you find you're working on the truth and the love aspect and you feel there are certain fears that are really limiting you, like you can't express yourself, you're unable to create the kind of connections with people you want because you have some social phobias, that's when, you know, that you're getting the signal. Now you better start working on the power side and building up that aspect of your courage and that aspect of, you know, your life as a whole. So, you know, the real message here is to think of personal growth, especially if you're, you know, fairly young, like in your 20s or even younger, think of that whole triangle, that truth, love, and power triangle, and use that as a guide throughout life. I've been using this for, you know, model for many years now, and I love it because it really shows me where I need to create my next, you know, growth experience, where I need to create balance. So, you know, like this fasting experience, it's not about power. It's not really about that. This is more about understanding more of the truth of how my body works, how my brain works, and connecting with that desire, that curiosity. So this is more of a oneness experience for me. It's not something that I feel requires at this point in my life an extraordinary amount of discipline. It's more driven by curiosity. So I hope this message lands somehow with you and that you'll take it to heart. You'll consider, you know, creating a more balanced approach to personal growth, especially if you've been following a somewhat unbalanced approach in the past, maybe too much on the truth, too much on the love, too much on the power. And consider the big picture there, and consider that, you know, if your weak area is holding you back, that is maybe where you should be putting more effort.